for God's mercy and that it happens and comes soon. So, all right. Would you turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 10? I don't know if you know who Richard Peck is. I don't know who he is. Maybe you don't either. But I hope he's a millionaire. Because about 50 years ago, Richard Peck, he was a traveling salesman, and he was an animal lover. And his times on the road, he showed him there was a lot of wandering pets, dogs out along the road, and he too often saw where dogs lost those collisions with vehicles. And he wanted to do something about it. He was very troubled, and he put his mind to it, and he began to think, and he talked to some engineers and such. And what he came up with was the world's first electronic pet containment system. What do we call that? Invisible fence. He invented the invisible fence. His name's Richard Peck. Now the dogs are free to roam the yard and without concern for traffic. A decade into their product, they reduced the size of the collar unit by 90% so that it could be put on cats, it could be put on small dogs and such. Now, what's a great idea for pets is a terrible idea for people. Yet a lot of people live inside invisible fencing that hinders their healing, it confines their progress, and it keeps them bound to lies and distortions. Way too many people live conflicted by the boundaries that other people have set for them. And they hear thoughts and voices in their head, invisible fences that say, you're not smart enough, you're not good enough, you're not enough, you don't have what it takes. And people hear this playing over and over in their minds. Nobody wants you, you can't keep up. This invisible fencing that dominates way too many people's minds and thoughts, contaminating lies that seem to confirm in their minds, this is just what I've always thought. This is just who I am. This is what I'm about. Now, we recently did a series on Pontius Pilate, and we called the series Conflicted because we looked deep into the mind of Pontius Pilate, and he expressed and exposed some of his conflicting thoughts. When he speaks to Jesus, the creator of the universe, standing next to him, and he declares, I have power. Pilate was trying to probably convince himself far more than he was thinking he could convince anybody else around him. When Pilate declares, I am innocent of this man's blood, he was really trying to just overcome his own sin and shortcomings and trying to convince himself. We're going to take this same idea of conflicted, but rather than start with Pontius Pilate, we're going to look at some scriptures that help us address our own conflicted thought patterns, our own conflicted mindsets. 2 Corinthians 10 is the scripture, the key scripture today, and each week, or the next 2 weeks also, we're going to look at key scriptures that talk to us about our own thought patterns and what the invisible fences are that keep us limited and hindered and small. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. I want to focus on that key phrase, bringing every thought captivity into obedience to Christ. That tells us that our thoughts run wild. That tells us that our thoughts go crazy, that our thoughts can lead us in directions of disobedience. It also tells us it's possible to take those thoughts captive with a power that we don't possess. So we're going to talk about that. Now, when it comes to thoughts in our head, what we often do, the soundtrack that's in our mind, often causes us to think outside of ourselves and to look everywhere else for blame. Our problems are always somebody else's fault. It's easier if I blame somebody else. I look elsewhere. I don't have to accept responsibility when I blame somebody else. I don't have to change when it's somebody else. I can expect or demand that other people change when it's all their fault. And when it's not mine, I've avoided any kind of blame or responsibility. It's also safer if I blame somebody else and I look elsewhere for what's going on really inside my own mind. Then I don't get blamed. I don't feel guilt or shame. It's also socially acceptable to blame everybody else. People go on social media, claim their victims, try to criticize any organization or entity or leader or person. And as long as they have somebody else to blame, it's actually socially acceptable. And they get a lot of group hugs and they get people coming around them. That's okay. I'm so sorry for you. It's so unfair. Life is so unfair. But even when we're looking elsewhere, we're still so conflicted. Despite everything that we've done, trying all our efforts to cast off shame and guilt, we still feel it. Despite blaming somebody else, we still live behind an invisible fence. I make too many mistakes. I'm not good enough. I don't think God loves me. No one seems to care. I can't stop doing this thing. John Maxwell, in his book, 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership, he called it the law of the lid. And he talked about how you put fleas in a jar, and he said you can actually train the fleas, at least that's what he said or he heard. And you put the fleas in a jar, and they keep bumping into the lid, and then you could take the lid off, and they just bounce, they just jump as high as the top of the jar, and they don't jump ever higher. Because they've learned from, now it's an invisible fence over the top of that jar. Stephen Furtick called it the chatterbox in his book, Crashing the Chatterbox. John Acuff's new book is called Soundtracks, and it talks about the thoughts that go through our head, the soundtrack of our mind that continues to play and hinder and diminish. Les and Leslie Parrott call it self-talk, and Craig Groeschel in his book calls it the battle for your mind. But whatever we want to call it, all of these messages that rattle around in our noggins, they hinder our potential. They keep us locked behind barriers that nobody else sees. But they continually draw us to unhealthy people, and they continually move us toward destructive behavior, and they continually limit us in our potential, and they keep us from obeying God fully. We hear all these voices in our head, and they tell us we're not enough. And no matter how irrational this self-talk is, we believe it. We don't ever seem to ask, who told us that? Who came up with that? We listen to it and we believe it. And when we hear some message that confirms that self-talk, we embrace that message. Yeah, see there, I'm no good. See there, I'm not enough. See there, that's exactly what I thought. That's just who I am. And then when we hear a message that contradicts that, we say, well, they don't know what they're talking about, or that's just not true, or that's just a one-off, that's an exception, that's not who I am. We disregard anything that contradicts this pre-conformed mindset. Now, is there any hope of breaking through this invisible fence that keeps us locked in these patterns? Now, when God is involved, there's always hope. So we're going to look closer at this text from 2 Corinthians. Because a lie that's believed as truth will affect your life as if it's truth. So I want us to stop giving power to those lies in our head that determine what our boundaries are going to be. You are what God says you are. You are not what that person says or what circumstances have dictated. You are what God says you are. So we have a reset for our minds. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh, but the weapons of our warfare, they're not fleshly, carnal, human, but they're mighty in God to pull down strongholds. And he says we're going to bring every thought captive their obedience to Christ. Now, we've been thinking these thoughts. We've been living inside this invisible fence for so long that we let them define us. We believe them as true, and we don't even question them. We just accept them. This is just the way it is. This is just who I am. So let's first of all recognize the battle. Let's recognize the battle. In verse 3, he says, we do not walk according to the flesh. We don't war according to the flesh. Even though we're in physical bodies, this battle is not physical. It's a spiritual battle. It's a mindset. Let me give you an example. Let's say that you're getting in trouble at school, and so you change schools. But if you don't ever change your mindset or attitude, if you don't change your thought patterns, what happens at the new school? Get in trouble. You gravitate to the same kinds of people. Let's say that you and the boss are clashing at work. And somehow that boss is always, you know, a problem, and he's got this authority thing going. And so you change jobs, but you never change your mindset. You never change your attitude. You never change the thought patterns. What happens at the new job? Well, that boss at that job, too, has got a problem. He's just got big problems, and he's bossy, and he's loud, and he's obnoxious. And so you change jobs. So let's say the spouse is bad, and they don't do this, and they don't do that, and they don't do this. So you change spouses, and then they're the same way. And how often do people gravitate to the same kind of person and the same kind of person? Physical changes don't get to the heart of the problem. There's an invisible fence that attracts you to these kinds of people. There's an invisible mindset, thought pattern that draws you to certain circumstances and people, to the crowd with destructive habits. You don't just get in with the wrong crowd. Your heart is drawn to the wrong crowd because of some thought pattern in your mind. What is that invisible fence? What is that thought pattern? What's the soundtrack saying? A reset needs to occur. In Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, it says to keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. Guard your heart. It tells us that the heart or the mind is the source from which the rest of life flows. We're constantly moving in the direction of our strongest thoughts. So the question becomes, do I like where my strongest thoughts are taking me? Do I like to be going in that direction? Romans 12 and verse 2. Says, do not be conformed to the image of this world, but be transformed by renewing your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. This tells us that it's possible to change our thinking, to renew our minds, to come to a place where the thought patterns that have led us toward destruction can be changed. What does the soundtrack of your mind tell you? God offers a reset. He offers a different message, truth. Now, most of us are oblivious to the boundaries that we have in our minds, to those thought patterns, because the soundtrack has been playing so loudly, and it's been playing for so long, the fence has been there for so long, we just think that's normal. That's just how I am. That's just the message that I hear. So the first step in the process is to recognize the messages that I'm hearing may or may not be true. I can examine them. There can be a reset. Did you know that there's an option about whether to believe those messages in your mind or not? There's a message, there's an option whether to believe those or not. And the battle for your life is won or lost in your mind. Your thoughts. So here's what we need to do to destroy strongholds. And verse 4 uses the word strongholds. Then verse 5 says thoughts. It's telling us that the thought patterns in our minds are strongholds that prevent God from working, that often prevent us from obeying. They prevent us from fully living. And so in conversations with people, we've worked through a little bit of an exercise where I say, I want you to write down the messages that you're hearing. Write them down. Terry asked me yesterday, we had a little time. She said, hey, tell me about the message tomorrow. So I began to tell her about the soundtrack, the messages, the invisible fence. And she says, I got one for you. She named it right away, way too fast. And she said it. She goes, you say this often. Just relates to some area of my life. And yeah, I do. And that hinders me in that area. So write down the messages. Just begin to think about it. Because they're so much a part of our minds that we don't ever objectively consider them. I'm not enough. I'm a failure. I moved away. They left. This, whatever the message is, write it down. And then, secondly, after you begin to write them down, and I've had people actually do it, I want you to write them down. Then, secondly, ask critical questions. Who decided this? Who told me this? Where did this come from? Is this accurate? Give you a little example. Several years ago, one of my daughters was in high school, and they were studying the body mass index there, and BMI, right? So I say, hey, put me in there. Put my 6 foot tall, 190 pounds, put it in there. She said, well, Dad, says you're overweight. Overweight? That's the first time I'd ever heard that in my life. My mom used to take the skinniest jeans they sold and sew them up, take them in. So then I said, who made the chart? Who decided that? And how many people are basing their worth and value on a chart that they don't even know who made the chart? And they've given power to their lives, their eating habits. They've given power to what they see in the mirror. To a chart they don't even know anything about. They don't know who wrote it. They don't know who created it. But somebody said, overweight. And I just immediately began to think, how many anorexic people are locked in some invisible fence because they've given power to somebody? I remember an insult some kid gave me on walking into school on the first day of seventh grade. And man, I thought about that, and I don't know how much it affected me, but I spent a lot of time going, yeah, well, he thinks I'm this. You should see what he is, and you're this. Why would I give power to that person? So let's ask critical questions. How do I know if that's true or not? Why would I believe this? Who told me this? Why would I give them power to determine who I am? And the third step in the process is to counter that, to seek God's truth. To seek God's truth. Now, please recognize, when I say God's truth, I'm being redundant and repetitive. Because all truth is God's, and everything God says and does is truth. So I'm being redundant there. But just to make the point that it's God that is the source of truth. It's not that kid telling me whatever he said as I'm walking into the school building on the first day of school in seventh grade. It's not that mindset that I've had in the back of my mind that my wife way too easily pointed out to me yesterday. Stop, she says. When we seek God's truth, it changes us from Bible reading. Well, I'm just turning the pages. Okay, I got that one done. I got that one done. It changes Bible reading to I'm seeking to find out who God says I am. What does God say I am? You're not what others say about. God says I'm forgiven. so I don't have to live with the shame and guilt in my mind, the fear of being exposed. God's already forgiven me. God says I'm his child, so I don't have to live with the shame or guilt of whatever somebody's done to me. I don't have to be defined by my sinful past because he's forgiven me. You're not what others say you are. You are who God says you are. That's why it's God's truth. Francis Schaeffer called it true truth. But in this process of recognizing the battle and destroying strongholds, we're going to have to access a power that we don't possess. We're going to have to admit we need some help from outside of us. And in our text, it says that the weapons of our warfare, verse 4, are mighty in God to pull down strongholds. Mighty in God. Our own thinking got us in this mess. Our own thought patterns that we think are normal, we think are us, we think define us, they got us where we are. It's going to take some outside capacity, the truth of God, to bring about that reset in our minds. God has the capacity. You don't have to fight this alone. Now that word stronghold is fascinating there, pulling down strongholds. The first century Greek folks used that word stronghold to talk about a fortress or a castle at the top of a hill. You know, with the brick, the stone wall around the outsides of it on high ground. And the longer you believe the message in your head, the longer you believe the lie, the stronger the fortress is. And every time you repeat the lie, another stone gets added to the wall and it gets thicker and it gets higher. And we think that wall is protecting us from risk. We think the wall is protecting us from fear and shame and guilt and exposure, when really all that wall is doing is keeping us confined and limited and small. God, for too long, I believed the message that I'm no good because of what my uncle did. I want your help to get to the truth that I'm worthwhile and valuable. God, for too long, I've listened to the message that says I'm the sum total of my mistakes. I want your help to see that I'm worthwhile and valuable. God, for too long, I've blamed others, feeling like a victim, and letting life happen to me. I want your power so that I can begin taking initiative in life. God, as long as I can remember, I thought I was unlovable. I need your help to understand how much you love me. I remember a day when I was 15 and my dad took me to a spot and he said, here's the shovel, I want you to dig a hole. And I'm going to leave. When I come back, I want the hole dug. And I said, man, why don't you get a backhoe in here? And he said something very clearly. He said, you're cheaper than a backhoe. I'll be back. Now, it wasn't a very big hole. It wasn't like I was digging a 100-yard trench. I was just a whiny kid. But there's certain jobs we all recognize. We should get a backhoe in here. When it comes to resetting the thought patterns in our mind that have so hindered us, how about we get some heavy equipment? How we get the mighty God who has the capacity that we don't have to move some dirt? You see, God is the source of truth and he's the source of power. Some more examples. I'm a victim. Nothing good ever happens to me. Is that true? What's God say about that? Romans 8 and verse 37. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. God made us to be overcomers, not victims. So if I ever resort in my mind to saying I'm a victim, then let's immediately go to God's truth. God made me to be an overcomer. So God declares, I am not a victim, I'm an overcomer. What about another lie? God can't be trusted. I trusted God and bad things happened and things didn't work out. I'm going to have to take control of my own life. Romans 5 and verse 8. God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You mean even in my mistakes, I was lovable. Even in my guilt and shame, God still loved me. So the declaration is, God loves me more than I love myself. He knows me better than I know me, and he loves me. And even when I was a guilty sinner, Christ died for me. Now, how long do you think you would have to work on this to overcome your lifetime of living with that invisible fence? Do you think that once would do it? Do you think that twice would do it? Do you think that one day? Because what's going to happen is you're going to develop that answer, the God's truthful answer, and you're going to tell yourself that one. Get that thought out of my mind. You know, this applies in the area of sin and temptation as well. Just this once. How many sins have been committed with the phrase, just this once, rattling around in their noggin? So the truthful answer is, it will only make me want more. So every time we begin to think, just this once, we respond with, it will only make me want more. That's the truthful answer. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's finished, brings forth death, James 1. So it applies to sin. It applies to temptation. The battle for your life comes down to the battle for your mind. And so many of us live with conflicted thoughts. Write down those messages that you're hearing. Ask critical questions. Is this true? Who told me this? When did I start thinking this? Where is this coming from? What is the source here? And then seek God's truth. It changes our Bible reading. It changes how we listen to Christian music. When we listen to Casting Crowns, their song, The Voice of Truth, the waves, they're calling out my name and they're laughing at me, but I choose to listen to the voice of truth. When Lauren Daigle says, you say I'm not enough. I'm hearing those voices in my head say I'm not enough. But you say I'm loved. You say I'm valuable. You say I'm worthwhile. And a person can read the Bible, but if they don't grasp, this is God's message to reset your mind and your thinking. Then we're going through motions. John 8 and verse 32, and we'll close with the scripture. You shall know the truth, and the truth will get rid of the invisible fence in your life. The truth will make you free. Don't let the invisible fence of shame keep you in hiding. Enjoy God's forgiveness. Don't let the invisible fence of sin keep you small. Enjoy God's power to defeat sin. Don't let the invisible fence of victimhood keep you angry. You see, our significance comes from God. Let's stop giving other people the power to determine who we are. And let's give that to God and his mighty power to overcome the strongholds that limit us. That make us small. Would you stand with me, please? With heads bowed and eyes closed. Father, across this room, in pretty much each of our heads, are some invisible fences. Some of those invisible fences keep us sinning. Some of those boundaries keep us small. They keep us afraid. They keep us ashamed, guilty. God, I pray that today, every one of us begins the process of recognizing the lies, asking critical questions, and then seeking the truth, God's truth. Thank you that your mighty power is available. We're not left on our own with an inadequate shovel to dig a hole. You have your mighty power available. May we claim that today. God, would you reset our thoughts so to bring them into obedience to Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you all so much for being here. You are sent.